Mine's pointing sideways or something.
Wyatt, yeah, you'll get music as soon as I get what I need here. I don't... See, I play it by... Yeah, Bork. Brack. Brack. Now, this show's lab will be seen in the... the thing I always have to work on is the universe... Hello, hello. I'm way down here in the gain here. Hey, hello. How's Mike watches me in there. I think Mike's a little dumbfounded to see the pros at work here. You realize that, Mike?
Matt, I'm a little dumb.
Matt's looking in here with great amazement. He's not used to the old pros here. You see, it's like watching Roger Maris sitting over there at the corner of the dugout, quietly waxing his bat. You know, he's just sitting there. He does not look nervous at all. All right, are all set to go now? All righty, row.
Well, Doctor, do you have the victims ready there? they're on the operating table now. We have the anesthetic machine going. As Mr. Thurber would say, we have them ready now. And, Doctor, here is your scalpel. You can go to work on their brains any minute now. Come, victims, let us go. We will go into the area. Fantastic imagination. We will deal with you as an experiment. Okay, all set, gang. Yeah.
Have you ever had the sinister suspicion that you could be part of a vast experiment? A, that you could be, and in fact all of the world we live in, our whole universe, can be merely a smear on some fantastically immense microscope slide? A, we are part of a controlled experiment.
It's time now for the Mad Scientist Hour.
That's enough of that jazz. I see by, excuse me before I go into this series. This is for the benefit of the women and children who are unfortunately tuned in at this time. We must give you a disclaimer. This will be a very serious type show. This is what we call, in the files of Shepherd and Peace and War, we call this a deepie. Once again, looking through our vast files, once again taken from the true life files of J.P. Shepherd, we bring you the case of X-17. As our story opens in a small Midwestern town. Now take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park. Buy some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't give a doggone whether I never come back home. It's root, root, root for the home team. Oh boy, will we swing out of the old wall. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park. I'll buy some peanuts and Cracker Jack. The more you eat, the more you want. I don't care if I never come back. To the root, root, root for the home team. Hooray, Kansas City Athletics! What a rotten bunch! Oh, hooray! Very good, very good. Say, I'm singing up a storm here today. And before we go any further, speaking of the loud singers, the people with the deep resonant voices, it's time for Guess What? Do you want to hear more of that song? I must say, and of course, it's true, there's no question about it. I am a deep, died, totally dedicated, completely, I'm oozing. There's no question about it. I ooze like a, like some kind of a big fat cheese Danish. I ooze a peculiar kind, I must admit it, I'm not denying it, a kind of dynamic American incipient corniness. It's just there. It's vital. It flows through. Of course, this is because I grew up with an old man, my father, who the only time he really radiated, you know, I'm sure that many of you have fathers who are hung on serious literature. You've got fathers who knows what, anthropologists, archaeologists. Maybe you got a father type who vibrates to Wall Street. Some fathers vibrate to bit. My father couldn't have cared less for business. It's a fact. Now, it wasn't that he was an artist or anything. He always went to business. And he would always stay behind the cage, you know, and he was working in this office. I remember going down to the office, and I as a kid, they would allow me to go through all the waste baskets. That's a funny thing. I don't know why I brought that up. But when he would always be in this big office, you say, a couple of hours after all the other guys had gone, and I would go through these gigantic waste baskets they had with the long ribbons of paper and all that stuff, and I'd go through looking for things, you know. But that never did it to him. The only time the old man really began to stir was in the very early days of spring and the last few days of winter. He would be sitting there at the kitchen table. We had one of these enamel tables, you know, with the chips on it, those porcelain-type tables, and he'd be sitting there, and he's been in hibernation all winter. He has said very little. Just sit there and come in and out and go and drive the car and yell at the snow and all that stuff. That's about all. Then all of a sudden you would begin to hear a little stirring by the table. There would be an announcement in the paper. He's going through the Tribune. All of a sudden there would be the announcement. It would say, Luke Appling signs pact. Luke Appling signs for the coming season. The Chicago White Sox were beginning to burrow their way out of the cocoon. And, of course, you'd hear the wind blowing outside. The wind would be howling off the lake, and the snow would be piling up higher and higher. And the old man is waiting. Luke Appling signs pact. And at the bottom it says, Wild Bill Dietrich, Bullfrog Bill Dietrich, returned his contract unsigned. Bullfrog Bill has returned his contract unsigned. It looks like trouble out of Comiskey Park. Bullfrog Bill refuses to accept the miserly terms that the Chicago White Sox have offered him. After all, Bullfrog Bill had his best season last year. For crying out loud, after all, he won 7 games. He only lost 18. Why, the year before that, he only won 5 and lost 23. He had his best season in years, and these guys want to give him a contract with a lousy $45 a month raise. Bullfrog Bill returns packed. And there you'd see Bullfrog Bill looking out with his glasses, a typical White Sox pitcher, a little fat guy, you know, he's got glasses that are twisted. You could see there was a thumbprint on him. His hat didn't quite fit, sitting on the top of his head. He's squinting out at you. That squinty little picture. The Bullfrog Bill spurns pack. And the old man is coming back to life. He says, Bill isn't signing. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park, Comiskey Park. I'll buy some peanuts and Cracker Jack. Get them all stuck in my teeth. Don't care whether I never come back home. Take me out to the ball park. Which route for the home team? Well, of course, this is part of my deep, rich American heritage. No question about it. And so at a very early age, I would, you know, kids are always attuned to their fathers. They really are. And I couldn't, you know, what did I know about baseball? I mean, the White Sox, this big thing that he's reading about. All I knew, it was a big thing. It was a very happy thing when Bullfrog Bill would sign the pact. Well, now, we would go out to the ballpark. Now, I don't know whether you've ever grown up under this aegis, the old man who is dedicated to baseball. Dedicated. Do you know that to the very day my father died, the major tragedy in his day, the major tragedy in his entire life, was the Chicago Black Sox scandal. He was a mere stripling.
He was living in the Chicago White Sox neighborhood. He lived on the south side of Chicago. He was a pool room type, you know. He was hanging around the pool room and yelling and hollering and working as a messenger boy for Western Union and all that stuff. And the absolute light, the sun of his life, the moon, the universe, was down there at 35th and Shields, right in the heart of Chicago's teeming, festering south side, 35th and Shields, Comiskey Park. Oh, boy, old Comiskey Park would sit down there at those old green walls. You'd see those stands standing up against. It was the biggest thing for miles around. You see, down on the south side of Chicago, they didn't have skyscrapers there, you know. They just had a lot of tenements, and they had the stockyards. Everything is low there, you see. They had all these crummy little houses, these little brownstones and bungalows, and busted-down fences and cobblestone streets. It was a steamy, fetid countryside. How many of you have ever read James T. Farrell's Studs Lonergan trilogy? Well, that was written and done during that day when my father was growing up on the south side of Chicago, and Lonergan, Farrell was growing up in the same neighborhood at the same time as my father. Have you noticed that James T. Farrell, one of the great American writers, at least he's turned out a couple of great American books, certainly the Studs Lonergan trilogy could be nothing but America, at least it was Southside Chicago. He has never gotten baseball out of his skull. Have you ever followed anything about Farrell at all, Mike? Well, Farrell, even to this day, keeps writing little books about baseball, and here's a guy, you know, he wrote one of the great American classics, the Lonergan trilogy, and why? Well, you have to understand the south side of Chicago to understand why every man who grew up at that time in that section of the country, right there on the south side of Chicago, it was the only thing. It was the only thing that had any majesty, any grandeur, any drama in their whole life. I mean, they lived in pool rooms. They spent all of their evenings trying to steal wire from the Edison Company. Flip rides on the streetcars. That was about it. But down at the end of the street, guess what? Comiskey Park. Comiskey Park. That's where the Chicago White Sox played the New York Yankees. That was the one touch with fantasy, reality, defeat, and most importantly, victory. They were the only people in the whole neighborhood who ever won anything. Nobody won on the south side of Chicago, except the Chicago White Sox. They were first place in the American League. They were knocking the stuffings out of the Yankees. The Detroit Tigers weren't even in it with them. The Cleveland Indians? Kid stuff. Shoeless Joe Jackson, the peerless center fielder. Yes, sirree. Buck Weaver, the sensational third baseman. The sensation of the entire league. Little lefty Dick Smith, the fantastic, tiny, left-handed pitcher who hurled for the White Sox. They were victorious all the way. They led the American League 3-4 straight seasons. And all those little pool players, all those little wire stealers, all those little guys who spent their evenings hooking rides on the back end of Chicago streetcars, every afternoon were out there to see the only victory in their entire lives. Shoeless Joe lining one into the lower deck. And the thing about the Chicago White Sox ball players of that period is that they were like the guys who came to see them. They were all poor working men. They were not the kind of ball players that you see today. No, Shoeless Joe, do you know that Shoeless Joe Jackson, in his best year, the best outfielder in the whole of all of baseball, the heaviest hitter, the best fielder, you would not guess how much this poor guy earned. $2,100 for a whole year. You feel sorry for him? Let me tell you this. You know, it's funny. People laugh at that. Somehow, a man who has a certain artistry in a field, and it's a tough field, boy, baseball, a talent to thrill people, a talent to make people come and watch him, a talent to, in fact, exceed all of his fellows, is a talent not to be laughed at. I don't care whether he writes. I don't care whether she dances a ballet. I don't care whether he gets up and pretends he's an ancient Danish king. This is talent. And out in center field, old shoeless Joe Jackson, a simple guy from the simplest of all backgrounds, and that's why he was called Shoeless Joe. Shoeless Joe Jackson stood atop a pinnacle beyond all reason at 2,100 poor, sad little dollars a year. And don't say that was a lot of money in those days. It wasn't. It really wasn't. Bartenders earned more than that. But Shoeless Joe would go drifting back near that fence in Comiskey Park with that easy, majestic grace of a born hillbilly who had spent all of his life going up and down mountains and crossing great plains without so much as even breathing heavy. Shoeless Joe would stick that skinny little glove up in the air and snag one of those hard, long, high shots off the bats of one of the New York Yankees, and without so much as even looking back, casually flip the ball in the lower deck to his fans. Shoeless Joe Jackson, the peerless Chicago White Sox outfielder. And then, one evil, dark day, late in October, the Chicago White Sox are playing the Cincinnati Reds for the World Championship. And everybody in the Western Hemisphere knew that the Chicago White Sox could make mincemeat of these panty waists without even so much as breathing heavy. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 majestic games were played. And the Chicago White Sox went down to ignominious defeat. And Shoeless Joe, out there in center field, kept chasing those balls around, making those long throws. And somehow, it didn't look right. Somehow, Buck Weaver wasn't going to his left like he used to. Somehow, that peerless shortstop, a heavy, great jaw, the Swede at shortstop, somehow was just kind of missing those plays around second base, just by an eyelash. Yeah, things weren't right. My old man sat out there in Comiskey Park and watched. What's the matter, fellas? Hey, hey! In the good old summertime. La, da, 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 da. Okay. Now you have to understand the majesty, the incredulousness, the total disbelief of the entire city of Chicago, particularly the South Side of Chicago, when it turned out, get me that ball game thing. Don't give me the summertime. Give me the ball game thing there. When it turned out late the following year that the Chicago White Sox had thrown the World Series. They had accepted money from evil gamblers from the East. New York Sharpies had come into town and bought out old Shoeless Joe, who didn't even know what he was doing, who bought out the Swede at shortstop, and 8 of the Chicago White Sox players had sold the entire South Side, the pool players, the flippers of rides on the back of Chicago streetcars, the guys that spent their nights stealing wire from the Edison Company just to get a few pennies together to go to see these guys. They had sold them down the river. It would be almost tantamount to find out that the British royalty were secretly working in league with Hitler and were planning to sell out the entire empire. Buy me some cracker jack, some peanuts. I don't care if I never come back. Take me out to the ball park. Take me out to the game. Da-da-da. Which route? Route? Root for the whole team, and they're throwing it, they're throwing it. Where am I going to go now? Now you know something about the extent. Shouldn't do a show like this. This is confusing everybody. One outfit that never sells out, of course, is the sales department. Well, I can only tell you this. That I lived in the same house with a broken man. My I'm not kidding. You know, it seems funny. You laugh at this, but you know, you've got to realize that the people who grew up and who lived in the, maybe you don't know. I guess outlanders don't know the difference between the north side of Chicago and the south side. To them, it's just Chicago. Well, the north side of Chicago is the other world. As a matter of fact, you know, Chicago is one of those rare cities in the entire world where the two halves of human existence can be literally seen merely by taking a short ride on the elevated. Now, it's true, and it has nothing to do with slums. You don't go from slum to the good section, nothing like that. There are two kinds of Chicagoans, absolutely two kinds. People in New York don't understand quite what that means. You have to live and grow in the city to appreciate it. That the north sider is as different from the south sider, well, as the, I can only say, as maybe an Englishman is as different from a Dutchman. And they live in the same city, and there is an implacable, a completely indestructible rivalry. It isn't really a rivalry. It's as though they look across their city from one end of the city to the other with great uncomprehending eyes. The south siders look at the north side, and the north side doesn't even know the south side is there. And that makes for a very interesting city. And so the Chicago White Sox were more than just a Chicago ball club. They were the South Siders ball club. And the greatest moments in all of baseball in Chicago, never the World Series, because the Chicago teams are hardly ever in it. It was never really the games against the Yankees. It was those fantastic afternoons late in the fall when the Chicago White Sox would take on the Chicago Cubs in the City Series. It was like the good guys playing the bad guys, really. You never heard such wild, nothing to do, 50,000 times greater than Brooklyn playing the Giants in New York. Now this, I'll tell you one of the reasons why the myth grew so great in Chicago, in New York, that this is the greatest intercity rival. You know, the old Dodgers used to play in New York, used to play in Brooklyn, the old Giants, was because almost all the major syndicated sports columns come out of New York. And so it is assumed by the world, because they get these syndicated columns all over the country, it is assumed by the world that all the great things in sport happen in New York. And so, sure, you know, all these New York writers, but they don't understand, they probably don't even know, they can't even touch. You'd have to live in Chicago, grow in Chicago, and particularly on the South Side, to appreciate this peculiar tension that went day after day after day. You'd pick up the paper, and my old man, I can remember my old man sitting there. Of course, he was an absolutely dedicated South Sider. Well, dedicated, he was born, he wasn't a baptized South Sider. He grew in a pool room, you know. And he'd sit there, his old man was killed in the stockyards, you know, and he lived there, see. And all of his life, when he would walk around, there would be the aura, the aroma of the stockyards clinging to him. Just like, you know, there it was, you know. And all it was there. So every day we'd get the paper and he'd look at it and be silent. The White Sox dropped another one. That was all right, you know, he expected this. Because the White Sox always dropped another one when I was growing up. But two columns over it would say, Chicago Cubs wallop Giants. This is what hurt. This is really what hurt. Roy Parmalee blanks the Giants. Put the paper down. Look out. Look out over those long, dreary fields of the Midwest. And once again, he had tasted the ignominious, not only the taste of defeat, but the taste of total, just complete erasure. Didn't exist. Look out there. It was like, you know, you can't understand this. And he would be in a foul mood all that night. He would be, you know, foul. Get out of here, will you? Quit bothering me. I'm reading the paper. Read the paper. He would look with uncomprehending eyes at the paper. Sit there. And then about 8 o'clock at night, after the dishes were put away, he would begin to pour it out. I can't understand. Look again. What's going through Dykes' head? He's talking about the Chicago White Sox manager. What? No. And my mother'd say, "What's the matter?"
He took Krivich out for a pinch hitter in the seventh inning. Who did he put?
He'd sit there for a minute. And my mother would try to calm him. She'd, "Well, you know, Mike hasn't been hitting lately."
Say, "Well, no wonder he hasn't been hitting. He's not using them."
Again, an ideological argument. There'd be a long pause. And then the next day, of course, bright and sharp and cheerful, he's up at 8 o'clock in the morning. It's a new day. It's a new day. The White Sox are taking Cleveland again. Big Vern Kennedy is going against them. And this was the ace pitcher for the White Sox. Or Big Bill Lee was going for the Cubs. My old man hated Lee, see. Vern Kennedy is going for the White Sox. But who's going for Cleveland? Picks up the morning paper. Bob Feller. Bob Feller's going for Cleveland. Holy smokes. Well, look out there. You know, the sun is shining. Hope springs eternal. And he'd be ready for another day. He's all ready.
Oh, take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park. Peanuts and Cracker Jack and everything. I don't care if I don't ever come back. It's root for the home team. I'll sit out there. I'll bet
many a guy's idea of total heaven is to be in a box seat back of third base throughout all eternity with his ball club up at bat, with the bases loaded, and the slugger is standing down there in the on-deck circle waving four bats over his head, and the opposing pitcher is looking a little shaky. He is consulting with the catcher now. The first baseman is coming over, and they're all standing around the mound, whispering, contriving. What do we do now? Which way? And the manager of the opposing team is waving the outfielders around. Back, get back, with the scorecard, get back. And the slugger is advancing to the plate. This is an idea of heaven that many a man have deep down in the circles of their heart. Believe me, they can see this eternity throughout all existence. They're sitting back at third base, and there he is. Big Moose is pulling his hat down over his eyes. He spits. He's waving that bat over his head. And then the manager, the home team manager, calls him over. There's a brief consultation back at the screen. And the slugger looks down at the coach at third base. They're giving him the swing-away sign. The hit-away sign. It's up to you, Moose. There they are, all three of them. The bags are loaded. The home team is one run behind. It's the last of the night. And the opposing pitcher is beginning to develop a very bad flutter. On that curveball, take me. In the good old summertime. Oh, it's always summer in this dream. In the good old summertime. La, da, 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 da. Oh, yes, somewhere there is a heaven where all the ball fans are sitting there. And by the way, the home team is changeable. Wherever they are, someplace, some poor little guy is sitting in his own heaven. And believe it or not, the Philadelphia Athletics are coming to the bat. And standing up there at the plate for the Athletics is Big Al Simmons. Big old Al waving that bat around, that strange stance with the foot in the bucket. And over there at third base, back and forth he goes, is Mule Haas, the greatest Athletic of them all. Dancing around second base is the peerless Jimmy Dykes, the great Athletic. Oh, man. Now, this is a very special show, you know. I'm sure that the ladies are not going to know what I'm talking about. But the names I have mentioned are names that will stand forever in the pantheon of baseball fans. These are true gods. You ever hear about Mule Haas? What a great nickname, Mule Haas. And you know why they call him Mule Haas? He had a very interesting swing. Mule Haas was a fantastic ball player. who played on a ball team so great, so absolutely peerless, that it got to the point where even the home team fans did not go out to see them, because they beat everybody down into the dust. Mulehaus, Jimmy Dykes, Al Simmons, wow, what a trio. They played with the great Philadelphia Athletics, and they were at George Earnshaw. I can remember my father, he burning with hatred. The Athletics are in town. I'm just a little kid, you know. The Athletics, burning with hatred. These guys were the snottiest ball team. You think the Yankees is? Oh, you never saw anything like that crowd. And my father is sitting out in the, but we're back at first base, you see. I remember one day, it's clearly delineated. And down there, right in front of us, is one of the peerless left-handers for the Athletics, is warming up. And my father is livid. He had that snotty way, just warming up, you know, that casual easy. He's flipping that ball down to the Athletics catcher. He's going today, see. Big George Earnshaw. He's laying it in there. And the old man's out like, "Hey, George! Chicken!" Chicken. That was the one thing that Earnshaw wasn't. Chicken up! Hey, choke up! My father had played semi-pro ball, and he knew all the words, and he had the fantastic hatred of a semi-pro ball player. You know, there's one thing about the partially talented ball player. He gets by on sheer anger, venom, guts. Oh, yeah. And, you know, like Eddie Stanky. Stanky never really hit a ball. Stanky attacked a ball. When the ball would come down there, Stanky would throw everything, his head, his ear, his arm, his foot, anything in the way of the ball to try to get it away from home plate, you know. That's the kind of ball player the old man was. He's on a choke up! Well, I remember this afternoon vividly. We're sitting, don't worry, hon. We're sitting about three or four rows back of the, right back of the box seats. Right there, you know, we're right down on, and here in front of us is George Earnshaw warming up. The peerless pitcher of this absolutely paragon of ball teams. And way out in center field, shagging fly balls, is Al Simmons. Did you ever hear of Al Simmons? What a fantastic ball player. And there is old George warming up. See, he's laying that ball in. And in just a moment, immediately after the commercial, I will tell you of one of the most embarrassing moments I ever had as a kid. Oh, boy, what a moment. Stay tuned. Well, the old man, you know, he was a baiter. Now, he never baited umpires. He was mad at ball players. He was mad at ball players who came in and made monkeys out of the White Sox. Of course, you've got to understand that during these days, the Chicago White Sox had long since gone down in the West like an MGM musical. And the White Sox consisted of the most hapless crowd. If you think the Mets are a sad ball club, let me tell you, the Mets got a reason for being a sad ball club, you know? They're a new ball club, after all. But the Chicago White Sox were really down in the dust. They were eighth place in the American League year after year after year. And year after year, in would come the Yankees. In would come the Philadelphia Athletics. And you got to remember that my father had grown up during the days when the Chicago White Sox of his youth would take the Philadelphia Athletics and twirl them on their finger like a hula hoop, you know? They would play with the Yankees like a yo-yo. Oh, boy, the Chicago White Sox of his day. And now here he is. It's like an old Southern family, you know, who has lost all of its mansions. It's lost its ground. And now all it is sitting in a little shack. And boy, does it get bugged. It looks all of the rest of these people out. Well, that was the way the Chicago White Sox fans were of my youth. They were men like my father who had known grandeur, real grandeur, of Shoeless Joe, and they had also known probably the most incredible betrayal in all history of sports. They had not only known betrayal, but embarrassment. You know, you can argue away when your ball club loses, believe me. You can say, well, I mean, if a Yankee fan sees the Yankees lose the World Series or something, he can say, well, you know, what happens when the ball club sells out? How can you argue that away? And all over Chicago, Cub fans were saying, you were following those bums, don't tell me, the White Sox. Oh, bunch of crooks. Oh, my father would walk around in the pool room. you know, crooks. Sure, crook, what am I? You know, it's like I'm a crook. I'm somehow, you're touched with sin yourself, debauchery. So here it is years later, see, and these are these betrayed fans out there, and now all they got left is anger. Nothing else. Honor, it's long since gone. Glory, forget it. And out in center field is Mike Kriebich, a good, solid 182 hitter. I mean, you know, old Mike back and forth, he goes out there looking like a little fire plug, you know, an angry little ball player. Boesberger is over at third base. Boesberger, in his best season with the wind behind him, was a good 150 hitter. Boesberger. Over here at first base, big banana nose, Zeke Benora. Banana nose, you know, he had a radius, a fielding radius of roughly 10 inches. Zeke Benora was made out of lead. He was a great big lunk of a guy over there, carried his glove hanging down. He didn't need the glove, so he never got the ball, you know. So he just hang it down there at the end of his arms. He just stand there, big old Zeke walking around there. You know, the Zeke led the American League in fielding. He really did, with an average of about .997, because he never went after a ball. You know, you can't make errors when you don't go, you know. So he just stood there, see. He made one error, and that was the time that the ball came to him. And so that's why he didn't have 1,000 that year. You know, came right at him. He couldn't get out of the way, but hit him. So they gave him an error. Well, that's Zeke Benora, banana nose Zeke. Well, it's that kind of ignominy, you see, that the old man. And here is the Athletics are in town. Well, now, they didn't have Mike Kriebich playing center field. Who do they have? Al Simmons. Oh, 375. This guy hit with his eyes shut. He did. What a slugger. He'd hit those long, low shots that would continue to rise. In fact, one went right over the stockyards, 4 miles away. And as far as is known in Chicago, is still heading towards Canada. That kind of hitter, you know. Mule, Haas, you know why they called him Mule? He had a strange swing. He swung, according to legend, the way a mule kicks. He had a strange, fast swing. It just goes pow, like that. Real fast. You know, the mule is legendary for being the worst kicking animal in the world. Not because he kicks hard. He kicks fast. You're standing there 1 minute, and the mule is just standing there scratching, chewing his feet, you know, just standing there like an officer. Pow! You get it between the eyes. Gone. That's it. Like lightning. Well, that's exactly the way mule would stand there until the last second. The ball is coming down at him. Till the last second. He didn't seem to swing. It was like he was going to let the ball go by, and then all of a sudden the bat would go, pow! That's it, triple. Well, that was Mule Hines at third base. So the old man is bugged, you know. They had George Earnshaw, who had won like 48 games that year already. The best Chicago White Sox pitcher, it was late August, was now working on his fourth victory. You know, that kind of thing. 17 defeats. The Bullfrog Bill is going. So the old man is bugged. We're sitting out there, and Earnshaw is just throwing that ball down, you know, that casual throw that the winners always have. You know, they're playing it easy. They're playing these patsies. And there's a, you know, it's a double header. The White Sox had a fantastic crowd out there. They had over 400 people that day. And so, you know, he's playing it, and the old man's yelling. And you can hear him all over the park. That was the sad part of it. You know, when there's no ball, when there's nobody there, and Comiskey Park is a great big echo chamber. It's a giant echo chamber. You can hear guys yelling. You can hear guys out in left field. You can hear one little guy hollering, "Yo, ball!" It would echo all over the park, you know, and all the way out to Shields Avenue. Listen, I'll tell you the rest of the story immediately after we get back after this commercial. Hang on. How much time do we have, Lee? 5 minutes? Oh, good. Well, we can... All right. Since we've only got 5 minutes, and this kind of story will appeal to a sport fan. I know that. If you... Because, gee, what a terrible thing. And it's also one of those moments when kids... I don't think a kid ever has a more embarrassing moment than when he sees the defeat of his father. This is incredible. Oh, boy. I mean, you know. And so, since we've only got 5 minutes, let's take time out now, Lee. Come on, put it down in a note. We're going to take time out for another commercial. Hang on, gang. Well, I am sitting there next to my old man. So, you know, I'm proud. We're out at the ballpark, and I've got a box of Cracker Jack in my hand, you know, and the PA system is playing, and everybody is having a big time, and they're all waiting for these fantastic Athletics to take over, you know. You can just, it's just all there, you know. Take me out to the ballpark, oh, wow, and I'm there, you know, with my old man. Take me out to the game, oh, and the old man is sitting there with his straw skimmer, Cracker Jack, hot dogs, the whole scene. We're going to root for the home team. Of course, we worship them, even though they were rotten. And the one great ball player the Chicago White Sox had was casually leaning out of the dugout watching the Athletics, sharpening his fantastic batting eye. Poor old Luke Appling. Luke Appling led the American League, you know, in hitting one year with an average of 388. Put that in your ear, man. 388. And batted in 27 runs. There just were never any other White Sox on base. Nobody ever got on. Old Luke, all by himself, is playing the whole league. He's looking out there. Well, George Earnshaw is warming up. Just casually back. You know that nice snapping slap sound of a pitcher that's beginning to get that feel? You know, he's beginning to get the arm warmed up and he's working gradually. You watch a pitcher warming up, a really good pitcher, and he does it gradually. First, it's the slow, you know, just lobbing them. And after about a couple, 3, 4, 5 minutes, you see the ball is beginning to pick up. And now he's at that stage, you know, where he's just landing in. You know that sound of the ball hitting that catcher's glove, you know, pow! It's like that. Ooh, wow, that's a nasty sound. You know, you know he's really meaning it. Pow! It goes like that. And the catcher's down there lobbing it back. Pow! He puts it in there. And then he looks around, and he looks kind of up in the stands. He's getting the lay of the land. Earnshaw looks up. Great big guy. Big George Earnshaw. And he's sort of lazy-looking cat. And he turns, kicks the dirt again, spits, and he lobs another one down. It just, without even so much as an effort, you know, he just lobs it down. But it goes, pow! And it hits that catcher's mitt. He looks around. The White Sox are staring in abject fear out of their dugout in Earnshaw's land. And my old man is hollering, "Choke up!" You see, what had happened was a week before, Earnshaw had been knocked out of the box. See, and the old man had read that. And so he's after him. He says, "Choke up! Hey, the Tigers! Uh-huh. How about the Tigers, Earnshaw? Oh, choke up!" He had been knocked out of the box by the Tigers. See, so Earnshaw, pow! He lays another one in there. And the old man is yelling. You can hear him all over the park. All over the park. He's about 30 feet away from Earnshaw. "And before we give you the denouement, hang on, gang. Here they come." Pow! The old man, "Choke up, Earnshaw!" Well, Earnshaw looked suddenly from under his cap right at the old man and me. He's maybe 15, 20 feet away from us. He just looked. He had this big black hat with an A on it. You know, just looked right at us. And I'll never forget what he did. He just went like this. He went, "Ugh!" He made one jump towards my father. Just, you know, a mock jump. He went, "Ugh!" And the old man went, "Ugh!" Back. His hat flew off. And Earnshaw just sort of grinned. And all Earnshaw said was, "Choke up." The old man sat there. He was 2.5 inches tall. Just sitting there, you know, with his hat on top of his head. And I sat next to the old man, and about 45 fans sitting around us go, you know, they're snickering. Hey, go on, fella, tell him. Go on out there, tell him who's tougher on this ballpark. Go on. The old man is sitting there. It wasn't until late in the fourth inning that he recovered his voice. And around about the fifth inning, he was back in full form. "Choke up, Earnshaw!" But this time, Earnshaw was out on the mound, spinning a two-hitter. By the way, the White Sox lost that one 4-1. They finally did get a third hit, a scratch roll bunt down the second, right down to the second baseman who came in fast, tried to field it, fell down, and he was saved by an eyelash. It was a typical White Sox hit of the period, by the way. And the old man hollered immediately after that, "Earnshaw, they're getting to you!" Well, it's spring's eternal, friends.